Hello everyone, this is Mirzai from Cal Poly Pomona, and in this lesson we're going to learn branch and bound method to solve integer linear programming problems. Suppose you're given a linear programming problem as shown on this screen. This is a simple linear programming problem. However, if we add the condition that x1 and x2 are also integer, then this problem is going to change to an integer linear programming problem. And the solution method that we previously learned, such as simplex method and graphical method, no longer can help us to find a solution to this problem unless we make some modification in our steps to tackle this problem. Let's solve this problem regardless of the condition of x1 and x2 being integer. So for the time being, suppose that this condition doesn't exist. In the context of linear programming problem, we call this relaxation of integer condition. So every time we relax a constraint, it means that we ignore that constraint, or we assume that that constraint doesn't exist. So suppose that we relax the assumption that x1 and x2 are integer, and we're trying to solve this problem using the graphical method. If you recall previously, we had to find two points for each of these lines, and also we have to find the direction that satisfy the constraints. So in this case, I find two points for the first line, 0 and 5, 5 and 0. And if I connect these two, this is going to be the line related to the equation. And the side that includes point 0 and 0 is the side that I'm interested in. Also, for the second line, I find two points, 0 and 4 and 7 and 0. And if I connect these two points, then I get the second line. And point 0 and 0 satisfies the constraint that I have, and therefore I'm looking at the side that includes my center of the coordinate. Now the intersection of these two region is shown by yellow on this screen. So if you recall, to find the optimal point, we have to draw the objective function line and see which corner point is the one that is going to be hit at the very last as we exit the feasible region. So because this region is a convex region, or we have a convex set of solutions, we know that our optimal solution lies in one of the vertices or corner points of this feasible region. So I'm going to find the corner point that is generated as a result of constraint 1 and 2 intersecting each other. So I'm going to intersect the two line, and the result of the equation gives me the point 7/3 and 8/3 for the corner points that is the result of the intersection of constraint 1 and 2. And I know the other corner points here are 5, 0, this one is 0 and 5, this one is the center of coordinate 0 and 0, and the other corner point that we just found is 7/3 and 8/3. So since it's a convex set, one of these corner points are going to be my optimal solution. I draw the objective function line, and as I exit the feasible region, the last point that is hit by the objective function line is the point 7/3 and 8/3. So that becomes my optimal solution. However, we don't have a typical linear programming problem here. Suppose that now we're back to the initial problem where x1 and x2 now are integer. So that means your solution space is going to change like the figure that is shown here. No longer any point inside that yellow region is a feasible solution. Only the integer point, for example, point 1 and 1, 1 and 2, 1 and 3, and so forth, are going to be the solution. As a result, this optimal solution that we previously found by relaxing the assumption of x1 and x2 being integer is no longer a feasible solution for us, because 7/3 and 8/3 is not an integer solution. So how do we tackle this problem? The problem now has become very complicated because your solution space is no longer a convex set. And that brings a lot of complexity to the solution method of these problems. Also, one thing that is important is that your integer solution is not going to be obtained by simply rounding down the 7/3 and 8/3 that you have found. As you see, in this example, your optimal solution is not 0.212, which is the result of rounding down 7/3 and 8/3. Now, let's learn branch and bound method that can help us to find the best integer solution for this problem. So we start the branch and bound method by relaxing the assumption that x1 and x2 are integer, just like what we did in the previous slide, where we found the solution for the problem, 7/3 and 8/3, and the result of the objective function was 27.67 if you replace x1 and x2 in the objective function. So this is the starting point for branch and bound method. Then after that, you start branching on one of your variable that has decimal values. So right now, both of our variables have decimal portion. We pick the one that has the largest decimal portion. In this case, the decimal value for x2 is 0.67 and for x1 is 0.33. Since 0.61 is greater, I'm going to branch out on x2. There are different methods that has been used in literature for branching, to start your branching. Sometimes people pick one of the variables randomly. Sometimes they start from multiple variables at the same time. So there are a variety of branch and bound method out there for solving integer programming. But in this course, what we do, we always go off of the variable with the highest decimal value to start our branching. So if x2 as a decimal value is not an acceptable or feasible answer for this problem, we start branching on x2, meaning that if x2 cannot be between 2 and 3, then it has to be either less than or equal to 2 or greater than or equal to 3. So I'm going to branch on the x2, the value of x2, so x2 either is less than 2 or greater than 3 because it cannot be between the two. Now what happens is we have a new problem, new linear programming problem. This new problem includes the initial or original problem that we had in addition to the new constraint that we just added here. So basically now you're solving this subproblem, the subproblem that includes the original problem plus adding x2 less than or equal to 2. Now I solved this problem graphically so you can see this step and see what happens. So that was the original figure that we had. Now we're adding a constraint that x2 is less than or equal to 2, that removes this part of the feasible region and you're left with the bottom part. If I draw the objective function line and exit the feasible region, the last point that I hit is going to be that intersection point, which is equal to x1 equal to 3 and x2 equal to 2. So that becomes the new solution when I add that new constraint to my problem. So you can solve this new problem by putting it in an Excel solver or just solving it graphically. Sometimes because the number of decision variables are more than 2, you're not able to solve it graphically. What you need to do is to actually add that constraint to your to the previous step problem and solve it using analytical tools if you want to follow the step-by-step and branching and learn the branching process. Now from the results, you can see now both x1 and x2 are integer and the value of objective function is 27, which is very close to the 27.67 that we had. And you see that x1 and x2 are not simply calculated by rounding down these x1 and x2 here. Their x1 now is 3 and x2 is 2. So we consider this as a lower bound for our problem. It means that you're trying to maximize, but we found already an integer solution to this problem, which has a value of 27. And so far, we haven't found anything better than 27. Is there a way that we can get anything better than 27 in terms of our objective function? If you look at the value of objective function up here, with the condition of having any value for x1 and x2, the most that we reached is 27.67. And that means the best integer that we can probably get, the closest integer to that objective function value, is going to be 27. And we already achieved that 27. However, for the sake of understanding how all the process is going to work, all the branch and the processing branch amount is going to work, I'm going to follow along the other branch and we'll see how we end up having x1 equal to 3 and x1 and x2 equal to 2 as our best solution or optimal solution. But for now, we call it a lower bound because we assume that there might be another solution that beats this solution or is override this solution. But at least we have a minimum maximum value that we have found so far. From another branch that we have here, again, you have to add this constraint to the original problem and solve it. I'm going to solve this graphically here. This time, to the original figure that I have, I add x2 greater than or equal to 3, which shrinks the feasible region to that yellow triangle on the top. And if I find the best solution there in that feasible region, you see that x1 becomes 1.75 and x2 is equal to 3. And the value of objective function is 26.75. Now, is this a solution to the problem? Not yet, because your x1 is still is not an integer value. It has a decimal portion. And remember, in all of these sub-problems, we have relaxed the assumption of integer x1 and x2. It means that we assume that there is no condition of x1 and x2 being integer, and we just solve the problem. But when we get the result, we don't stop until we actually get integer for x1 and x2, because that's what ultimately we want to achieve. So now we have to branch again on x1, because right now x2 is an integer value. We have to start branching on x1. So if x1 cannot be 1.75, it should be either less than or equal to 1 or greater than or equal to 2. So we add these two branches and try to solve the problem with addition of these two constraints. For example, in this branch, when you come to this branch, it means that you have to add these two constraints to your original linear programming problem. So now your problem, original problem, has four constraints. These two in addition to the original two that you had, and you can plug it into some sort of solver and solving it, or you can look at the solution by using the graphical method. So in the previous step, that was my image. I'm going to use that as the basis to add this next constraint, which is x1 greater than or equal to 2. So if I do that, let's add this x1 greater than or equal to 2. If I do this, there is no feasible region left. There is no intersection between problem constraints. Basically, this problem have no feasible solution. So we stop this branch and continue on the other branch where x1 is less than or equal to 1. So this is the image from the previous step. Now I have to add x1 less than or equal to 1 to it. If I do that, let's see what happens. This time you're cutting off a small triangle on the right-hand side of x1 equal to 1 line, and you're looking at the left-hand side of the x1 equal to 1 line. So basically you have that small yellow region as your feasible region. And if you look for the best solution on the corner points, you end up with x1 equal to 1 and x2 equal to 3.42 with the objective function of 25.57. Is this the end of this branch? No, because now even though x1 is an integer value, your x2 has become a decimal or non-integer value. So we have to branch on x2 again. Now, if x2 cannot be between 3 and 4, it's either less than 3 or greater than 4. I take this to the next slide. So far, this is the image that you have from this branch, and this is the solution that you have here, where x1 is 1, x2 is 3.42, and I branched on x2, that either x2 is greater than 4 or less than 3. Now, if I add the new constraint to this image, I'm able to see the new result. I'm going to add x1 less than or equal to 3 to this image, and as you see, when I do that, that whole feasible region, the yellow part, disappears, and only this intersection of the line x2 equal to 3 becomes the feasible region now. Because the combination of x2 greater than or equal to 3 and x2 less than or equal to 3 becomes x2 equal to 3. And the only part of the x2 equal to 3 line that is intersecting with the other three constraints that you see on the graph here is going to be that portion. Now, if this is too complicated, you can always solve this problem using Excel Solver at each stage and see what the answer is going to be. Remember, you have to follow the branch and add all the constraints to your original linear programming problem to be able to find the right solution to your problem. Now, the solution this time, if I draw the objective function line, you see that it's the x1 equal to 1 and x2 equal to 3 with the objective function value of 23. So is this a end of this part? Is this a lower bound? If you remember, the previous solution that we found for x1 equal to 3 and x1 equal to 2 gave us objective function of 27. So 23 is less than 27 that we already found. So we call this branch a fathom because we don't really need this integer solution, even though we found it, but it's not better than what we found earlier. So we just have a fathom branch and we continue on the other branches. Now, if I had found a solution better than the previous one, this would become my new lower bound and the previous solution becomes a fathom solution. Let's see what happens with the other branch. So I'm going to add to this image the new constraint, which is x2 greater than or equal to 4. Let's do that and see what happens. So if I add x2 greater than or equal to 4, you see that the only point that is feasible is the intersection of x2 greater than or equal to 4 line with the x2 axis. And that gives us a solution of x1 equal to 0 and x2 equal to 4. And the value of objective function, again, is 24, which is not better than what we previously found. So this branch is also fathom. Now, we got to the point that all the solutions are integer and are not better than what we found previously. So we report that x1 equal to 3 and x2 equal to 2 as our optimal solution with the value of objective function being equal to 27. We kind of figured out at the very beginning that probably 27 is going to be our optimal solution. However, you don't always get that immediate solution in your first attempt. If you had started your branching from the right-hand side as opposed to the left-hand side, you wouldn't be able to know that this branch is going to give you the best solution until the very end. So it's always a good practice to follow along your tree, especially if it comes down to your exam and quizzes, so that you don't ever lose points for those. With this, our lesson in branch and bound has concluded. Thank you for watching.